Well, hail, Feather Sound Church. Ephesians chapter 6, the armor of God. Otherwise, this would just be awkward, wouldn't it? Today was bring your Roman armor to church day. Some of you missed the memo. Actually, I was thinking about this morning. My wife and I went to this fundraiser called Feast with the Beast at the Tampa Zoo for a ministry in Africa. And it said the dress was safari casual. So I dressed up like Indiana Jones. I had the whip and everything. And we walked in and it was crickets. 250 people there and no one else got the memo apparently. I think it was this elaborate practical joke. That's not the case. We are in the armor of God. If you're visiting, I don't normally dress like this. But welcome. You can scan the QR code and we have a free digital gift for you. We also would love to connect with you and we have a physical gift in the Welcome Center lobby there. But appropriately, actually, today or this weekend is Memorial Weekend. We're going to be speaking about a spiritual battle, but I'm so thankful that there are people who are willing to put on the physical armor and fight for freedom. Amen? So thank you for those who have fought and for the freedoms that we have now. I'm so grateful. We prayed for the Colemans, as you said. First service, they prayed for my wife and I. Today is my last service for a season with you to teaching. We're going on my very first sabbatical after 25 years of ministry. I'm super excited for it, despite the fact that the last 2 years have been the best years of ministry I've ever had. Just need a break, and our leadership has graciously given it to us. So the first part is rest and then rebuild. I'm taking a Greek class and finishing my book off, and then we'll be working on the five-year plan. So we will be doing 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. You're in great hands. This is the Lord's church. And our leadership is exceptional, and I'm so thankful for them. So Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, the armor of God for Christian warfare. So chapter 6, verse 10, Paul says, finally, as he winds down, be strengthened. The word from the Greek actually is the same word we get for dynamite. Have the power of the Lord and his mediocre strength. Vast strength. Look at the point is life is a spiritual battle. And here's the deal. We so often in our American mindset, we go and we try to do these things in our own strength. I've done it over and over and over, and it's foolishness. I have a very mediocre amount or a minor amount of strength. Why wouldn't I want to tap into his vast strength, right? The one who spoke with his mouth the entire universe into being has offered his strength to us. It would be foolish not to do and access that instead of doing things in our own strength. But it's human nature because we don't understand the nature of the battle. We're going to go on to talk about it because what happens is it'll end up burning you out, and I've been burnt out, and it ends up frustrating because we'll fail. I just finished this morning. I entered the book of Ezra. But before that, the whole section for the last couple of weeks has all been in the historical account of the kings of Israel. And you see it played out really well. One of my more favorite stories is how Asa stood in faith. A million man army has come against him from Ethiopia. I mean, can you imagine? A million people coming against you back then. Maybe you could muster up 200,000. You're like, this is not good odds. And of course, what does he do? He's afraid and he calls out to the Lord. And there's this incredible battle that is won that against all odds, they never should have won because the Lord was fighting for him. But what happened in his life because of that battle, he tended to think that it was his ability that and his might that won the battle. And guess what happened? A little skirmish happens between him and the northern tribes of Israel. Their king comes against him. He panics. He takes the treasury of the Lord and he pays off Aram. My enemy is the enemy of my enemy is my friend, right? And so he says, okay, I'll get this guy and I'll pay him off instead of trusting in the Lord. Now the prophet comes to him and says this. He says, because you depended on the king of Aram and not the Lord, the army of Aram has escaped you. For the eyes of the Lord roam through the earth to show himself strong for those who are wholeheartedly devoted to him. I mean, this is jam-packed. For those who have surrendered and put on the full armor of God and says, you're my commanding officer, God is literally looking to act mighty on your behalf. And you forfeit that when you go around and say, no, I don't need him. I'll do it in my own strength, our puny strength. You could do a whole message just on that. Verse 11. So he says, put on, he uses the word put on over and over, put on the partial armor of God. No, he says the full armor of God, so that you can stand, his stemi, you can stand against the schemes, the methodias, the word we get methods from, but it literally means the trickery methods, the trickery of the who? Devil. So here's what he says here. He says, look, you have to understand that there is a spiritual battle and there are schemes and trickery that are designed against you. They will come in this broken and fallen world. And so what we do is we so often think, and it says clearly, who does the trickery come from? Satan, the devil. So we go around and bad things happen because it's a broken, fallen world, and it is our fault. We chose to honor ourselves. We chose to not acknowledge him as our commanding officer. And we said, oh, I'm going to be boss. I'm going to be in charge. And what happened because of that, we turned things over to the devil and turned the title deed over to the devil. He now has an authority to operate. He messes with you externally and it messes with the sin that dwells within you, tweaking things. And we often shake our fist at God for all the crummy things that happen. What Paul is saying is, no, there's a spiritual battle. It's not coming from the Lord. It's coming from the devil. And if you don't put on the armor in the active sense, when the day of spiritual deception and surprise attack comes, and it will, if you don't already have it on, it's gonna be too late. Wait a minute, I didn't see this coming. Let me quickly put on my breastplate of righteousness, my belt of truth, my sword of the Spirit. Too late. And then you find yourself enslaved, and you go, how did this happen? Well, you know how it happened? You weren't ready. And that's the way it happens. Degrees, how our country has gone so sideways, it happened in degrees. Not putting it on. Or putting on the partial armor. You know what? I'm going to put this on, but I'm going to leave the belt of truth. And what has happened is now truth has become relative. I'll decide what's truth. Verse 12. For our struggle, our fight, or we don't wrestle, according to your translation, is not against flesh and blood. You know that your enemy is not your boss. It is not your spouse, the imperfect person that you married. It is not your neighbor who you are clashing with. It is not flesh and blood. And if you think it's flesh and blood, you'll end up fighting the wrong enemy and you'll fight with the wrong weapons. What is it then? He says, but against the rulers, authorities, cosmic powers of this darkness, against evil spiritual forces in the heavens. Why didn't he just say it's a spiritual battle? Well, there's different levels that he's talking about right here. And he says, look, you have to realize that there are different attacks, but it is essentially a spiritual battle. The rulers, or your translation might say principalities, are demonic spiritual strongholds, territorial authorities, I guess you could say. And to the Western post-industrial revolution mind, that seems like, that doesn't compute because everything seems physical to me. And I get physical, I get science and math. And he says, you forget that there isn't a completely entirely real dimension that is actually far more real than this. Just doesn't seem that way. Daniel chapter 10, Daniel prays. And then we find 3 weeks later, he goes, okay, Daniel, sorry. Michael the archangel shows up and says, I came immediately, but the prince of Persia resisted me for 21 days. Mind blown. I don't fully grasp it, but the Bible teaches that there is, because we've turned over authority, Satan is now, the Bible says, the prince of this air. So he has an authority structure in place, but he can only be in one place at one time. And so there are areas and territories like the prince of Persia that have been given over to the devil. And our goal is to fight against that. I think that there are areas currently of this country that are being turned over to the devil. And then he goes on and he says, there is not only powers or rulers and principalities, but there are authorities and powers. Authorities or powers, depending on your translation. What is that? Well, just like there is a territorial vast realm, and I don't know how far it extends. Does it come down to Feather Sound? Likely, but I don't know. That's not the point. There are rulers and we fight against them. But there are also, down to the individual, it is a battle. And what happens is when we give over, Paul said a couple chapters we give over with our sin that's unrepentant. That's why repentance is so critical for us. Is when we don't repent, what we do is we start to give the devil access to our life. He calls it, we give topos, ground, topography. We begin by our bitterness and unforgiveness. Oh, somebody sinned against you. Look at, that's tragic. You can't repent of that. But how I react, the Bible says, makes all the difference. And so I come and say, that's a wound against me. I'm so angry. I'm going to be vengeance. I'm going to come in with bitterness and unforgiveness. Unfortunately, what happens is it starts to give over little areas of your life. Not a big deal at first, but as that continues and soaks deeper and the roots go deeper, you begin to give ground over. You begin to give finger holds that turn into footholds, that turn into strongholds, that gives the enemy an opportunity to set up a castle and a fortress, which is hard to dislodge at that point of influence in our lives. Luke chapter 13, there's an account of a Hebrew woman who is bent over because it says for 18 years she was crippled by a spirit. I don't fully grasp how that works. It wasn't physiological. It wasn't, sometimes it's because there's a broken world. A broken world and DNA goes wrong. This was specifically somehow she gave over topos because of some sin that she engaged in. In your modern terminology, maybe it's pornography, maybe it's lying, maybe it's whatever. What unfortunately, if that is unrepented of, what we're doing is we're giving over ground that will logically eventually turn into a foothold and a stronghold, which gives the devil an opportunity. So he goes, look, you got to realize this is potentially part of the problem. And then he goes, the cosmic powers or the rulers of darkness in the NIV of this world. What that is influence at the demonic level over our power structures. Hitler. Hitler was clearly demonic. He had a fascination with the occult. I think Hollywood has been turned over to cosmic powers. Then he says the spiritual forces in the heavens. Those are like the current mysticism that permeates our age. And in our current age, it looks like wokeness and different things. It's a system of thinking that happens when we don't understand God's ways and we turn ourselves over, and there's a battle. There's a battle in all three of these planes, and if we don't understand them, we're gonna be susceptible to them because we won't be fighting with the right weapons. Verse 13, and he says, because of the fact that the primary battle is spiritual, take up the full armor. He repeats it again, a very Hebrew way of doing an exclamation point. Repeat, repeat. Don't take on the partial armor. Guess what happens? If you just leave it a part out, where are you gonna go? If you leave a part out, there was a guy who was a retired sergeant major in my first service. He came up to me and says, all I was looking was the gaps in your armor where I would stab you. I'm like, great. Hope you heard other things too. As a result, I tightened this part off because I had one more loop missing. Try to allow you to pay attention to the actual metaphor. Should I be concerned that he was thinking how he can stab me? Anyway. So here's Paul. We know these are the prison epistles, right? He wrote a bunch of letters from imprisonment in Rome. He's chained to a soldier. This is the ubiquitous lorica segmentum of the soldier. We all know it. You didn't go and say, I wonder why he's dressed like a Greek soldier or a Persian. You knew exactly what I was talking about. In Paul's day, especially Ephesus, a Roman colony, they knew what this was. And Paul's looking and going, aha, I'm going to do a metaphor, an illustration. And the reason I'm dressed so weird and I felt foolish at first, but you're going to walk out and I hope you remember this illustration that Paul is using as a picture. And he says, put it all on, verse 14. And then he tells us the things to put on in particular. And it's no coincidence he starts with this. Stand, esteemi, again, he says it again, therefore, with truth, like a belt around your waist. The very first thing he starts off with is a belt. Now, here's what you have to understand. The belt had an influence on every piece of armor. The breastplate was fixed to the belt. It held it, kept it in place. It held the sword in place. It Interestingly enough, a Roman, just like we have the patch right here and a patch right here on our modern military, this would tell the status and the rank of a soldier. Now, here's the thing about the armor in particular, starting off with this. If I said, using the metaphor, I'm in the Lord's army, right? And I never put any of this on, what would that signify? It would signify that I know that I'm my own commander. My commander says to put this on, and I don't do this. And I think this is what's happening so often with us as believers. We say, you know what, I'll put most of the stuff on, or I'll put that on occasionally. Here's what we're saying. We're saying, I'm gonna be my boss. I'm gonna be my superior. I'm gonna decide what's right for my life. I'm not gonna submit to that. It reveals a lot about who our commander is, whether we put it on or not. You know, I think about this, and we're a big fan of the Word of God. But the value of this right here, the belt of truth, the spiritual value of biblical truth, is not just in knowing it or knowing facts about it, but here's where it comes down to and where we always work and we move towards is the application. Why? Because what it's doing is we're allowing it, when we know it and apply it, we allow it to do surgery on the infection of sin. You know, I'm going on my sabbatical. I know you're not supposed to do this, but we're going away to North Carolina. I'm staying at Billy Graham's house, which is pretty cool. But then we're going on a cruise, which is so great, cashed in all those air miles. And we're going to Italy. And I'm teaching at Calvary Chapel Rome. So that's pretty amazing, right? When you're not supposed to do this, but when the church at Rome asks you to teach, you say yes, right? Why am I telling you this? I forget. Oh, I'm looking at what I felt like the Lord was putting on my heart to read, and I came across something in my old notes. And it said, and I thought it was so good, I had to repeat it. It's probably not my thought, it's nothing new under the sun, but it said, the value is in not just studying the scriptures, but letting the scripture study you. Do you see this? It is all about the application. If I don't let it study me, it does no good. I've got to put the belt of truth on, or I will be subject to my own truth. And that is exactly the poison that has turned a Christian nation into a post-Christian nation here. And Europe, the same thing. It keeps your spiritual pants up. Here's the other thing, is when there is something in my life that is not submitted in obedience to God's word, where do you think the enemy's gonna attack? That's exactly where he's gonna start. I mean, think about it. This is how it started from the beginning, Adam and Eve. The enemy whispered a lie, God's not good. God's holding out on you. You see the same thing today. In the middle of the storm, the battle. Oh, this feels so good. This feels so right. I deserve this. Oh, my spouse is treating me terribly. I deserve this. God should have let this happen and not this. And we start to hear the counterfeit, the lie. Part of my break is to do some education and to brush up, and I'll be taking some courses and classes and things like that. But I was gonna reread some of the stuff that C.S. Lewis wrote. You know what's interesting? But C.S. Lewis was an atheist, but he was an intellectual. And he started to be a little upset. He was an atheist, he said, because I would look around and I would see the cruel and terrible things that are going on in this world. And he said, why? How can a good God exist in a cruel and unjust world? But you know what? Quite independent of everyone else, he started thinking about that. And he goes, how do I know a line is straight or crooked unless I have a concept of what a straight line is? And he said, you know, I started thinking about the cruel and injustice. I thought, well, how do I know that something is cruel and unjust if there is not something that is objectively true, a measuring line, something that is unchangeable? And how do I know that there is something moral if there's not a moral lawgiver? And his thinking brought him to Jesus. Basically, he put on the belt of truth. You know, and that's why I said the enemy is getting away with such shenanigans in this country. And in our churches, we have completely walked away and said, we don't need that belt of truth. Look at the mess that the United Methodist Church is in. bastion of Orthodox Christianity for 200 years in this country. Verse 14. So he goes on to say the second thing. Stand, he says it again, be firm. Therefore, with truth around your waist, righteousness like armor on your chest. You know what the breastplate covers? The breastplate of righteousness. This is the center of mass. Any military person will say this is what you target. Why? Because it covers the most vulnerable areas of the body. I could take a shot to the arm, no big deal. I can't take one to the center of mass. And it covers your heart, your organs. In our understanding, the heart is the seat of the soul and our emotions, the things that make us most real. In the Greek thinking, it was the bowels. It's the same area. This all covers that. And we have to protect it. Now, you and I were created in perfection. We were created by a good God in a perfect relationship. We were created fully acceptable with meaning, a work and a purpose with a loving God. The problem is we believed a lie. We said God's holding out, his word can't be trusted. And what happened is that on that day, the shame came to Adam and Eve that they chose to follow their own heart. What is the first thing that they did? Is they sewed together fig leaves to hide their nakedness. And that's what we're all doing. We're trying desperately to come up with our own righteousness, to try to cover up my shame, to come up with a place where I feel like I'm worthy, that I am approved, that I matter. And it is a problem because it never works. Here's what we're doing. When I say, just like the fig leaves of Adam and Eve, I am putting on my own breastplate of righteousness. I mean, just think about it. I chose this perfectly because it's so foolish. Look what happens when it comes and I get attacked. I mean, I hardly had to even move, and this sword is even stretched, 250 years old. All I did probably, well, anyway. It's ridiculous. But this, in a sense, what we're doing, Isaiah actually says that all our righteousness, we're trying to earn it, is it's but filthy rags. It's a cardboard form of righteousness. The problem, Roman soldier didn't have to deal with this. The problem is that we can try for a season, but eventually it's gonna fail us. It destroys us. Because no matter how hard we try with our efforts, our works, there's always going to be some form of lingering sense of inadequacy, a feeling that we need to accomplish more, do more, work harder, to find that elusive sense of righteousness and worth. And the ultimate solution is the righteousness that doesn't come from me, because I'll fail. It's the righteousness that comes from Jesus. That's why it's the breastplate of righteousness from Jesus himself. It's his perfect righteousness credited to us by grace through faith. It's the only righteousness that can cover and truly protect our heart and our souls. I think we need to think this. It's not us living a righteousness and then offering it to God. It's God living, Jesus living a righteous life and then offering it to us. And so I put on his righteousness based on his finished work on the cross rather than my own efforts. And that's where I'm going to find true lasting acceptance and a secure identity that will never be shaken regardless of the battle and the storm in a broken world. Because he's the only one that will never fail. And so when we have that voice, which we all do, whispering to us, oh, you're no good. You're not good enough. A Christian would do more. He would work harder. He would sin less. What I do is I recognize, because I've got the belt of truth on, and I realize that it's not God's voice, that's Satan's voice. And then what do I respond? Here's how I respond. Yes, it's true. You're right. I'm not good enough. Yes, I can never be good enough. I can never do anything to earn it. However, where you're making a mistake is I'm not wearing my breastplate of righteousness. I have put on the breastplate of righteousness of Jesus Christ, and he is worthy. And that's where the victory comes from. You know, I think about this, and I recalled reading through my Old Testament study. I'm going, you know what? I don't think this was even Paul's idea. Now he's remembering it. He's recalling his understanding of the scriptures. And he's sitting there going, wait a minute, this reminds me of Isaiah 59. In Isaiah 59, it's a picture of God himself looking at the mess that our world had gone in. And it says, and he looked around. Yahweh is looking around for someone to stand in the gap. And it says, and he found no one. And he says, well, I will extend my arm and save. With my strong arm, I will save. And it's a messianic prophetic psalm. And in verse 17, it says, he will come and he will, through his Messiah, who will wear the breastplate of righteousness and the helmet of salvation. It was always meant to be in Jesus and never our salvation. Oh, I'm trying to save myself. No, it's only in Jesus. There was no one. No one, all the way from Isaiah's time, who could save. Now here's what happens. We have to realize that sin no longer has power over us because of his righteousness. And if I don't believe that, I'm in trouble. I have to understand, because of this breastplate, I am now right in my standing before God. That's what righteousness means. He looks at me now through the lens of Jesus, even though I still have sin that dwells within me. It's a beautiful picture. I have to believe it by faith because God says it so, because sometimes I don't feel that way. And when I believe that, what happens when the temptation and the yakking from the enemy, because it's a spiritual battle, comes to me, what do I do? How do I respond? You respond and says, I'm dead to sin. This temptation has no power over me because I have put on the righteousness by faith of Jesus Christ, and he is righteous. He paid my sin, and I'm gonna walk in that. Verse 15, Paul then goes on and says, and your feet sandaled with the readiness for the gospel of peace. The tevas of the gospel of peace. Okay, this is the closest I had, was these sandals. But the idea was, the Roman sandal was made of leather, all right? It was durable. But the distinguishing factor of the Roman military sandal was that it had studs on the bottom. And the studs were specifically in the middle of the battle, in the middle of the field, that you would stand firm. How do you stand firm? It's no coincidence that Paul purposely says that your feet are shod with the readiness of the gospel of peace. He's not saying be evangelism ready, which is a true application. What he's saying is, you stand firm when you understand the peace that comes from knowing what the implications of the gospel, which means in the Greek, evangelion means the good news. That there is good news that brings peace, not only vertically with man, with God, but horizontally with man. And we stand firm in what Jesus has done because of the gospel, that he is King Jesus. He has won the battle. He has conquered death. He has separated me from the sin. He is now seated at the right hand of the God, of the Father. He is seated down because the work is done. He is King Jesus, seated on his throne. The battle has been won. Now, there's skirmishes to be fought still, sure. Cleanup battles. And it is a battle still, and there are fights, and there are storms in this broken world. And if you don't understand the gospel of peace that comes with understanding what he's done, you will be blown to and fro, and the fight will come, and the fiery darts of the enemy will come in this broken world, and you will not stand firm. You will not have peace if you don't put on these shoes. It's this peace that gives me confidence by faith to stand firm. Isaiah 7:9 says, if you do not stand firm, you will not stand at all. And I'll be discouraged with the displeasing politics of today and the corruption in my dwindling bank account. The good news, I don't have to fight it. I have to stand firm, not on my own strength, but I put on the armor in the strength of the victorious Lord, who has vast strength, not my puny strength. And almost because he knows that we're so dull, four times he says, histami, 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 histami. We get the word antihistamine to put the block on. Stand firm. Stand firm when you've done it all. Now, he goes on in verse 16, in every situation. What situation? Okay, so when you come through a difficult situation, turmoil in a battle, do you have to sit there and go, I wonder if this applies to this situation? No, it means it applies to this situation. In every situation, take up the shield of faith. He says, take up again. Same word as he used before. The shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Again, it's an idea they would have understood. The Roman scutum was roughly this size. Ryan built it for me. I took my wife's Tupperware, don't tell her, painted it gold. What they would do is they would cover that two layers of thin wood, and they would cover it with metal, and they would place over it leather dyed red or whatever color. Before the battle would happen, is they would soak it in water. And this shield, the scutum, was only used typically at the fiercest beginning of the battle. You're going up against the wall. You're going against the initial battle, and you would pull this up. Now, they were 4'11" on average, so I'd be a monster. So the shield was covered a really good part of their body. And what happens inevitably, the enemy would start to volley a series of, I had fun with AI this week, a bunch of flaming arrows. If you didn't soak it in the water of the word, your shield would go up in flames. If it was soaked in water, it would extinguish those darts. They'd be quenched. And so Paul pictures the Christian faith as a spiritual shield. And it takes faith to take it up, to yield to the truth, because your feelings, so many of us are yielding to our feelings. Well, it feels, this is the way I feel. And he says, no, you have to do it by faith. Now, faith has a foundation on something, knowing that God has shown himself to be good, but you pick it up by faith. When in the middle of the storm and the battle, and you go, how does this work to good? You know what you do? You pick it up and you hold it. The dart comes at you. Like I said earlier, the wound that comes at you, and your natural thing is and tendency is to go, I'm going to take vengeance on that person. And you pick up this that's been soaked in the word, and you go, you know what the word says? Vengeance is mine, to trust me, God says in the middle of it. And you have to do that by faith, because everything inside of you, in every culture, every tribal culture is a revenge-based culture. The most natural thing to do is say, I'm going to be my savior. And he says, pick up that by faith, because it's not natural. Trust God. It's been soaked in the word, and he'll act on your behalf in his vast strength. You got a spouse that's particularly unloving, selfish. I pick up the sword, I pick up the shield, and I dart. I prevent and I block the darts that are coming. Any position that you have to live by faith. I will finish with this, something that I thought was really interesting that came to my mind. Do you know that when the scutum shield was most useful, it isn't used for the, well, it, when it was most useful in community, when it's been soaked. Don't miss the application. Look at this next picture here. This is called the testudo, the Roman tortoise. You know, if I'm holding this, what happens? I got four of my sides unprotected. But when I'm in community, my sides are protected. I got a brother and a sister that's got my back, that's got my top, that's got my side. It's been soaked in the word. What happens? It'll dry. If it's dry, it'll burn up. But here's what's happening right now. In particular, you say, I don't need church. I'm going to stay and watch online, which is good. The problem is you're not in community, or you don't show up or go from time to time. You have nobody who has your side or your top. And it's a recipe for disaster. You know what? I'd rather go and whatever, fill in the blanks. Well, I pick up my shield of faith and I say, I'm going to be at church. Because right now what I'm getting is I'm getting my shield soaked. In my quiet time in the morning, I'm getting it soaked. Otherwise, the darts overwhelm. Verse 17. He says, take up the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. The helmet of salvation. What does the helmet cover? Trick question. What is it? The brain. It covers your mind, the brain, the way you think. A couple weeks ago, chapter 4, we covered that the battlefield is the thinking patterns. The thinking patterns. And you have an enemy who wants to conform you to his image. in your thinking patterns. As a man thinks, so he is. That's where the battlefield is. You don't put on the helmet of salvation. You're going to believe the lies that are being flung at you, specifically to your mind. When you put it on, how we view everything changes completely. Your values, entertainment, relationships, how you spend your resources like time and money. What happens is when I put this on, what I'm doing is I'm subjecting my mind to the commanding officer and his instructions. If I don't put it on, I'm defaulted to being my own boss, my own commander, making my own decisions. Paul told us in 1 Corinthians, he says, no one can know the mind of God except for the Spirit of God. I have to put on the helmet of salvation to know the mind of my commander's instruction. If I don't, I will be blind even in my slavery. But the helmet of salvation means that we have, he says the helmet of salvation. By the way, the Bible paints salvation in three ways, past, present, and future. I have been saved by faith, by trusting. It's a one-time event, by trusting in the work and the person of Jesus, now surrendering my life to the commander. I have my future and eternity is secure from that moment. The Bible also, and so I put on the breastplate of righteousness. I have his righteousness, not my own. Stand before God Almighty one day and I say, he'll say, why should I let you in my kingdom? Well, I have Jesus' righteousness, not my own. The Bible also paints a picture of that we are being saved. And when it says that present progressive, it means that we are being saved, not from, we've been saved from the penalty of sin by the breastplate of righteousness. But we are being saved in the sense of the power of sin in our life. One day when Jesus returns and we go to heaven, we'll be saved from the presence of sin. But here's what's happening. As I put this on, what happens is Romans 12 tells me I'm no longer conformed to the pattern of the world, but I'm renewed in my mind by the belt of truth, changing the way I think, to have God's way of thinking. Our greatest need, by the way, good discipleship is simply teaching people how to think God's way instead of sinful man's way. If I don't put this on, I will never be victorious as I live out the Christian life. By the way, when I look at this, there's something that I think you should know. He says in verse 17, take the helmet of salvation. The word take, remember I made a big deal, he's used the word take already. Interestingly enough, he uses a completely different word for take. The word does mean take, but it has in the sense of when someone offers something to you. You could translate it as receive the helmet of salvation. He says, take up the full armor, take it up. You do it, you put it on. But he says, now receive the helmet of salvation. What does that mean? It means that the Bible says that whosoever, if you would come to Christ, if he is drawing you, he says, take it, receive it. He's a gentleman. He's not forcing the helmet of salvation on anyone. And I don't know if you're out here today and you were invited or you wandered in or how you're here and you're going through and you're saying, look at this, I'm really identifying with this. I've been through the ringer. I'm in the battle. Everything about my life seems to be turmoil. I see the battle. I need something different. The way I've chosen to live my life and the power of my might is not working. And the Holy Spirit is moving in your life. And he's saying, that guy, what he's talking about, he may look like a fool, but he's talking truth. Jesus is offering you the helmet of salvation. Stop trying to find your identity and your righteousness, your meaning, your purpose in your own strength. Take up the free gift that I'm offering you. That I went to the cross to cover your sins, not me. Jesus went to the cross to take your sins from you and receive it. If you can't point to a time in your life where you have specifically surrendered that to Commander Jesus, why not make that today? Why not choose this day? The Bible says it's not a matter of clicking your heels, no place like home. It's a matter of understanding that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. The gift, receive it. That if you confess with your mouth and you believe with your heart, You will be saved, not might be saved. It says you will be saved. And it's a matter of receiving it and saying, I trust you, Jesus. Would you be my righteousness? I've tried, I've failed. I'm turning my life over to you. Would you teach me to live? If you want to make that decision, you can do that in your own words right now. I think I'd be remiss not to just ask and say, is there anybody who wants to do that? You can come up afterwards, but is there anybody who would say, you're speaking my language? That's what I need. I need the helmet of salvation. Look, come up afterwards. If you're nervous, you can scan the QR code and click a thing that says, I made a decision. We want to connect with you because we have a whole set of resources to help you put on the armor so you don't have to fight the battle on your own. But I plead with you to come up afterwards. Now, he goes on, and the second thing he says is the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. This right here, God's written word, is the logos in Greek. The written word of God. Here he's saying, I take up the rhema word of God, the sword of the Spirit, which is the rhema, the spoken word of God. The sword is the gladius, the sword that they use for hand-to-hand combat. It's the only weapon here that's offensive. The rest are defensive. You put it on, it absorbs blows. This one is offensive. It's when you, here's the beautiful thing. He starts off the armor of God. He starts off with the belt of truth, which is the word of God, and he finishes with truth, which is the spoken word of God. It's victory is found sandwiched in truth, not my own sense of it, but what God has to say. Now, here's what happens. How you wield this is when you speak forward the logos word of God with the rhema word. Rhema word of God is the word of God spoken at a right time in a right place. So maybe through this message, some random thing I said, you're thinking, well, that's the third time I've heard that this week. That's rhema. Or maybe something in particular spoke specifically to your circumstances. After the message, I had several people come up and said, you won't believe this. I was at the beach and someone said, you need to read Ephesians chapter 6. First time that she was ever here. I said, that's the rhema word of God. Another guy came up and he's in tears and he said, what you said, I'd never seen it this way. That's the rhema word of God being spoken forth through the Holy Spirit to penetrate our hearts. Now, the wielded word of God, the sword of the Spirit, it's the only one that really needs to be trained in. The rest you just simply put on by faith. So how do I do that? The only way is to be familiar with it, to memorize it. Psalm 119:11, I hid your word in my heart that I would not sin against you. And over and over and over, in the middle of a situation, a battle, a dart, a flaming arrow, a storm, the word of God has come back. It's a man's glory to overlook an offense. It'll never come back if you don't know it, if you've not hidden it. Maybe it's a good refresher on our app. We have a weekly Bible verse. We've made this the year of scripture memorization. Maybe it's a fresh reminder to be hiding God's word, to be in it, to be reading, to speak it forth. It's the sword of the Spirit. Are you, Christian, asking him how to wield it? Are you going into a circumstance that's a storm, a battle? And are you going in, Lord, there's a spiritual battle going on with my spouse. There's a spiritual battle going on with my boss, my neighbor, whatever. Would you show me how to use your rhema word of God as an aptly timed spoken word? You know, I think last year we had foster kids and, you know, being uprooted as a three-year-old, it must be very traumatic, right? In the first number of weeks that one of them was with us, well, both of them, but in particular one, at 2 o'clock in the morning, he would wake up with night terrors. I don't know where that's coming up. And I'd wake up and I'd be like, oh, wired. And I'd sit with him and sometimes it would last for a long time. And he would stare off into space and there's like nothing you could do to console him. And I'm going, this is so weird. And after a number of weeks, I said to someone, I haven't slept in so long. And they said to me, well, have you ever considered that that might be spiritual? Oh, pastor, why didn't you think of this 2 weeks ago? And that night I prayed, 2 o'clock in the morning, I remember it was so incredible. I took up the rhema word of God. And I did battle on his behalf. And it stopped that night. Now, I'm going to show you what a dummy I am so you feel better about yourself. I'm on a mission trip in an unreached people group area. I landed and my back just doubled up in pain. And I was like, oh, this is insane. 3 days in, I made a comment to someone and I said, you know, I am in so much pain. And the crazy thing is, I don't even know how it happened. And they said, well, maybe we should pray. Maybe it's spiritual. Sometimes you have to learn the hard way, right? And that person prayed over me. And that moment they took their hands off me, because of the spoken rhema word of God, acting and doing battle on my behalf, the pain in my back went away immediately. Insanity. It's a spiritual battle sometimes. Taking our authority. Where does our authority come from? It comes from the spoken word of God. Interestingly enough, the temptation of Jesus in the desert, in Luke chapter 4, I think it is, what did he use as his spiritual weapon? Spoken word of God to the devil. Why wouldn't we take a cue from that? Proverbs 6:18-20. Now this isn't a piece of the armor, but it's how you do battle now that you have wielded the sword. He says, pray at the occasional time. Circle all and every in here if you're comfortable. Pray at all times in the spirit with every prayer and request. Stay alert with all perseverance and intercession for all the saints. That's pretty comprehensive, right? Pray also for me. By the way, interesting, this is the only time I could find Paul asking for prayer. He never prayed for his often sickness. He prayed, hey, pray for Timothy or whatever. He told Timothy here what to do, but he never prays for his issues. He just prays specifically that the message may be given to me when I open my mouth to make known with boldness for the mystery of the gospel. For this I am an ambassador in chains. Again, he's chained to a Roman soldier. Pray that I might be bold enough to speak about it as I should. This is how we do battle. Four times, stand firm. Once you've put it on, stand firm, put the block on. And the only way we can do this is if we trust. See, prayer is not natural. Nobody typically naturally wants to pray, because sometimes it takes a while to see the results. We don't have this ability to peer into the spiritual realm. I often think about, in the middle of difficulty, 2 Kings chapter 6, where Elisha, the Aramean army, is coming up against him. Elisha's cool as a cucumber. His servants petrified. His knees are knocking. And Elisha prays, Lord, open his mind, eyes, so that he would see that this is a spiritual battle, not a physical one, even though on the outside, it looks pretty real as a physical battle, right? And he sees that there is a surrounding them, this vast, far vast army. I've often prayed that. The first couple of years here at Feather Sound, I always say it was not a picnic. And I'd come home and I'd say, I don't know. I said, it shouldn't be this hard. And I prayed, over and over, Lord, just like Elisha, it would be so comforting for me to be able to see what's really going on behind the scenes so that I could do battle. But you know, by faith, I knew that this is my weapon. I knew this is what I do. And we'd get on our knees. And I'd come in early and I'd get on my knees. And we're in a season that the church is growing and there's such peace. And I'm going to tell you, it comes down to one thing and one thing alone. We got on our knees and we made prayer a priority. And there's people praying in that room right now. And there's people praying at 8 o'clock. And we're praying throughout the week. And we're making prayer a priority, regardless if there's a handful of people. And I implore you in your circumstances, get on your knees. When the battle comes, it is your only effective way of making progress. Daniel, I said in chapter 10 of his book, 21 days. Before it was a spiritual battle, before he even knew it was a spiritual battle, you lift up that shield of faith and you pray. And you do it by faith. I love the story in Exodus chapter 14. The people of Israel, they've been extracted from their life of slavery. They've been extracted from the world. They go out into the desert, this process of you conforming to God's image in the dry times. And it's all a big picture. The greatest army of all time, with all the greatest weaponry, decides this is a bad idea. We want you back. The enemy, when you're released from your slavery, he will always come and try to get you back, right? And so you're standing there and you're petrified. You don't have anything. You've just been let go from slavery. You have no spiritual weapons. And here's what he says. You could have fought back. I'm sure there's people who ran north and died in the desert. There's people who probably hopped in the Red Sea, afraid because they're doing that in their own strength. What a mistake that would have been. And here's what Moses says. I love this. It says that they were terrified. The only thing that worked is God, and Moses said, through the heart of God, break camp and stand firm. That's it, really? Are you sure there's nothing else we can do? He says, no, take the step of faith. It's not something you're doing. What you're doing by taking a step of faith is you're allowing God to work. You're showing, you're taking up the shield of faith. You gotta take it up. You gotta show some faith. They broke camp and they waited. And what happened? Something that no one had ever seen. The Red Sea parted. They crossed and they defeated the biggest, greatest, most powerful army that up to then had ever been seen in one fell swoop. But they didn't do a thing except listened. You know, I'm gonna close with this. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. I just went through Chronicles and this story so encouraged me. You can turn there if you want, you don't have to, but 2 Chronicles in the Old Testament, it illustrates this really, really well. And it says here, it's the story of Jehoshaphat and a coalition army of the Maonites, the Moabites, and the Ammonites. Three armies come against the southern tribe of Judah. He's petrified because it is a much bigger army. He doesn't know what to do. It says he was afraid. I mean, who wouldn't be afraid of a much greater army? And it says he resolved to seek the Lord, proclaimed a fast, gathered them together in verse 5 and 6. And in verse 6, it says he prayed. He says, Lord of our ancestors, you're the God who is in heaven. Do you not rule over all the kingdoms? Power and might are yours. Then in verse 9, he says, we will stand before this temple and before you, for your name is in this temple. We will cry out to you because in our distress, you will hear and deliver. You know what he did right there? He just pulled up the shield of faith. He says, I'm taking a step of faith and I'm gonna trust you in this. Verse 12, judge them, God, for we are powerless. I have no might. I am weak. I can't do this before this vast number that comes to fight against us. We do not know what to do, but we will look to you. Are you doing that? Are you taking the step of faith? In the middle of your storm, your battle, the darts, are you willing to take up that step of faith, that shield of faith, and say, I'm looking to you. I'm gonna come to you with the weapon I have. I don't know what it's doing. By faith, I'm told to do it because I know your scripture says that nothing extends the arm of God like prayer. And then here's what it is. All Judah was standing before the Lord with their descendants, their wives, and their children. And then Mattaniah stands up. He says, listen carefully. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast number, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Do you know the battle is not yours? It's God's. Oh, this is so good. I got Jesus bumps. For the Lord is with you. You do not have to fight this battle. Position yourself. Stand still. Sounds a whole lot like Ephesians chapter 6, doesn't it? Live by faith. Stand still. Put on the armor. And here's what happens. The Lord is with you. And they knelt low, fell down, and worshiped him. They stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel, shouting loudly. We're gonna do that. You can shout loudly if you want. Shiloh, we're gonna sing, God is so good. That's how we're gonna finish. You know what it says, verse 23? By the way, I have found nothing to encourage my faith to do battle spiritually as well as praising in the middle of the storm, the darts, the battle. Why? Because it makes no sense to thank God that things are the way they are and that he's gonna work things out to good. Nothing have I found that works like this. It says in verse 23, the moment they began their shouts and praises, the Lord set an ambush against the Ammonites, Moabites, and the inhabitants of Mount Seir, and they were defeated. It took them 3 days to gather the plunder. What a great story. It didn't happen immediately. It took a couple of days. Yours might take longer, who knows? It's something we do by faith, trusting. So how do I do that? How do I stand firm and pray? Well, you pray the word of God. You pray the Rhema word of God. It's the only way to really truly pray God's will, making it a priority. Maybe husband, dad, you should pray over your family, your circumstances, pray together, husband and wife, the big decisions that are coming up, and then the battle, get down on your knees and do battle on your knees. Let's stand together. By faith, let's thank the Lord that things are the way they are, despite everything going on around.